Welcome to the Council of Trent podcast, a production of Catholic Answers.
And welcome to another episode of the Council of Trent podcast. I'm your host, Catholic Answers apologist and speaker, Trent Horn. And we're continuing the series here on the podcast where we dialogue with people who disagree with aspects of the Catholic faith, both people who are Catholic or identify that way, and more often than not, though, people who are non-Catholic. Today, we're going to talk about the issue of homosexuality and LGBT. And normally, when you think of these issues, we usually imagine two actors, two sides on these issues. On the one hand, there are Christians who hold what the Bible says, what church's tradition, natural law, holding that homosexual behavior is sinful. And on the other side of the equation, we usually imagine those who are critical of that view are those who are not Christian. And in fact, many prominent atheists are very critical of the church's teachings on sexual morality in general. But there's another group whose voice I think needs to be heard, is not heard as much in the Catholic world, but is a growing voice in the Protestant world. And so I think it's one where we can have a very fruitful dialogue. And that is the voice of Christians who hold to the authority of the Bible, hold the authority of God's revelation, but believe that homosexual behavior is not sinful. And joining us today to talk about that is Brandon Robertson. Brandon is a noted author, activist, and pastor working at the intersections of spirituality and social renewal. Robertson speaks to audiences across the globe and has been an honored speaker at renowned institutions like the White House, Oxford University, the Peace Corps, and the Parliament of the World's Religions. He teaches seminars at San Francisco Theological Seminary and is a consultant and facilitator with Auburn Theological Seminary. He currently serves as the lead pastor of Mission Gathering Christian Church in San Diego, California, and serves as the executive director of Metanoia. He is the author of several books, including one we will discuss today, The Gospel of Inclusion, A Christian Case for LGBT Plus Inclusion. Brandon, welcome to the Council of Trent podcast.
Thanks for having me. It's so good to be here.
One thing I would like to add also as part of my introduction that our podcast listeners may not catch, but our video listeners may see, is that I don't know if you get this a lot. I get this a lot in my line of work. People saying, you're pretty young to be doing all this stuff.
Yeah, I get that almost every week at my church. So 27 years old, though, so I feel like I've crossed the barrier into the age where I can be doing this stuff.
You know, it never really changes, actually, until you look old enough to people, you never really seem old enough to people. I mean, now I feel old because I'm 34, actually. And so I'm married, I have two children. But no, I think no matter how many children I have or how many books I've written, I will still, as long as I look like a kid, people will say I'm a kid.
Yeah.
So I think that's...
I think pastoral ministry is going to give me gray hair pretty early, though. So I'm expecting to look older quickly. So.
I have children. They may do that, but I have sons. I've actually noticed with my friends, it's ones who have daughters that tend to gray. They tend to cause much more worry in their fathers than sons. So what I want to talk to you about today is the book you wrote, The Gospel of Inclusion, Christian Case for LGBT+, and this growing movement. And as I said before, we hear it a lot more. There are people within the Catholic world who have argued for this. I have books in my, I have a large library of them in my library. In my office, Daniel Helminiak is a former priest who's written on this subject. John McNeil is another. Their voices you don't hear as much. But the Protestant world is one where there's more diversity of opinion than in the Catholic world.
Totally.
It's kind of the nature of the game, right?
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about this kind of, this view, pro-LGBT plus view in the Protestant world and how you eventually became a part of it.
Right. So this view's been around in the Protestant church, really. I mean, for a very long time, but it really gained prominence in the 1960s. And I came to this, I grew up as a fundamentalist Baptist, as somebody who believed homosexuality was a sin. I used to be a street preacher in Baltimore, Maryland, where we'd go down and preach about abortion and homosexuality on the streets to people. Mm-hmm. And then when I was about 13 or 14, I realized that I struggled with same-sex attractions. And so I spent 5-8 years, somewhere in between there, trying to pray for God to take this away from me, trying to live a just, a chaste life. I had a girlfriend in high school. I did everything that I thought I should do. I went off to Bible college at Moody Bible Institute in Chicago. And during those 4 years...
Where Bible is our middle name.
Exactly. And a school that has a very traditional stance would agree mostly with the Catholic Church's teachings on homosexuality.
Right.
And I was mentored by a guy named Christopher Yuan there, who's a renowned Protestant speaker who is ex-gay. And I just began wrestling.
He's someone who claims to no longer have same-sex attractions.
So he would actually say he lived a homosexual lifestyle. God called him to what he calls holy sexuality. And so he still has the attractions.
He just does not, he doesn't choose to engage in that behavior.
Yeah.
Okay. Because ex-gay has different meanings for
totally,
people.
Totally. And so I was mentored by him, but reading the theology he was giving me and the broader theology, I began to ask questions as I learned about the context of first century Greco-Roman sexuality. Mm-hmm. And as I saw kind of the wavy approach that Protestants were taking to these six clobber passages in the Bible, there are some really good arguments.
That refer to homosexual behavior.
Right. Yeah.
Because that particular phrase, and we'll talk about that in a sec, my primarily Catholic audience, though not entirely Catholic, the podcast is growing. Even people who aren't Christian have enjoyed listening, and I'm glad that they listen. And if you want to support the podcast and allow us so I can have great guests like Brandon on. See, we're talking about sexuality, and I've already had a Freudian slip. That's the first one right off the mark. I'm sure there will be others. If you want great guests like that, be sure to check out trendhornpodcast.com. So, you know, we use the phrase clobber passages. That refers to the traditional 5 to 6 passages in Scripture that deal with sexual behavior between people of the same sex in some form. And so your journey of understanding what a Christian should believe about homosexuality dealt with theology, these passages, and other sources, I imagine.
Yeah, totally. And so we had, of course, as an evangelical Protestant, we had a less emphasis on tradition and more on what these six passages say. And that was kind of the basis for the whole argument against LGBT inclusion. Mm-hmm. And again, as I studied these passages, and I eventually went off and got a master's degree where I spent 3 years specifically studying this topic, mm-hmm. I found out that some of the non-affirming arguments were good. There are some really, like I think Leviticus, for instance, we'll talk about this later. I think the author probably meant what he said, when a man shall not lie with a man as with a woman. But then when you get to the Apostle Paul, I think there are some unique cultural context things that most Christians and Bible readers aren't doing the deep study to know.
Right.
And if we knew that, it would actually help us understand what Paul was actually getting at. And
your term non-affirming would be those who hold to the view homosexual behavior is sinful.
Yes.
Okay. Because there's different terms that people use, and a common one I've seen is affirming versus non-affirming.
Yeah.
Though it's always hard when you come up with terms to describe where people disagree about something, because the terms can always be weighted to be against, you know, so that one side has the term like, well, who wouldn't want to pick that term in the discussion? So for example, there's that. I guess I might lean more towards the view of traditional versus revisionist,
sure,
in the sense that there's a way that the teaching has been always understood and a new way of looking at it.
Yeah.
You know, so there's different ways to look at that. When did you change your mind on this subject? When did that happen?
It was essentially after I graduated Bible college. I was kind of in this place where I didn't know what I believed anymore, because it was really kind of an oppressive theological environment. You had to, Moody, for instance, you had to sign a doctrinal statement going in and sign the same statement going out in order to graduate, mm-hmm. which to me felt like they were saying no education or growth is meant to happen. You're just supposed to be indoctrinated. And the exact opposite happened for me. I came in with traditional evangelical theology and I left with more questions than answers. Moved to Washington, D.C., and during that period of prayer and study, I decided to say I couldn't figure out a reason why my faith would condemn this homosexual attraction. In all my prayer and ministry, I felt mm-hmm. like God was saying that I was okay to live into this identity that he created me with.
Now, clarify this to me, because I've seen in other interviews and things that you've revealed for yourself, you've used different terms to describe your own sexuality, queer, bisexual. What term do you use now?
Queer, bisexual, gay, all work, because I initially came out as bisexual. Bisexual means that a person is attracted to both genders, male and female. Mm-hmm. Queer is a word that's used in the progressive world, at least, to mean fluid sexuality in general. And gay is I would say I live a gay lifestyle primarily. I'm dating men primarily these days. Mm-hmm. However, my attractions are still queer/bisexual. So sexuality is complicated, and we can talk about that more.
Well, that's something I will certainly agree with you there, that sexuality in and of itself, just the different kinds of attractions and feelings that we have, can be complicated for people emotionally, psychologically. But I do believe morally there are some simple rules we live by. And I think all people, including yourself, we have particular black and white do or die sexual norms. So the question here is, how do we determine what those norms are, in particular determining what makes a sexual behavior sinful or not sinful, which we'll get into here. I want to bring up another name before we continue on, because I was introduced to this a lot back in 2000, I think it was 14, when Matthew Vines wrote his book, God and the Gay Christian. Right. And that one, you know, lit up the charts. A lot of people were writing responses to it. I wrote a response to it that's on our website at Catholic.com. And, you know, engage. These are arguments that I had dealt with a long time ago with people like John Boswell.
Right.
Hadn't heard much since then. And I think Vines helped to bring it back to kind of more of the younger Protestant evangelical mindset.
Right.
So I don't know how that played into your work. And also, if you have differences here, and you can help me if I'm, you know, I haven't followed the news completely. Vines, my understanding, and he's a young guy like us, yep, has this view, has a very high view of Scripture. He's an inspired word of God. I don't know if he believes in biblical inerrancy, but I think he does.
Yeah, he would.
Yeah, so he has a very high view of Scripture. And so he holds to the view that sexual behavior is not sinful if it's in a monogamous, committed relationship, whether it's two men, two women, or a man and a woman. But he holds, does he still hold to the view that it has to be a monogamous relationship?
Right. Yeah, he does.
Do you hold to that view?
I'm less convinced. Yeah. Me and Matthew, we emerged on the scene kind of at the same time. I started an organization called Evangelicals for Marriage Equality right when God and the Gay Christian came out. And so we've been walking this journey together. But I've come to disagree with the general, what's known as the revisionist approach. I just don't think it's super convincing at the end of the day. I appreciate his work, and I know it's helped a lot of people.
How would you characterize that approach of people like Matthew Vines?
I would say it's more traditional revisionist. It's saying these six passages have been misunderstood throughout Christian history, and here's how you should understand them. I say maybe that's true. And I think there's a broader biblical case to make for an ethical trajectory throughout Scripture that points to a greater vision for inclusion, not just for LGBT people, but for all people. And so that's the argument I try to make in my book.
So I would see that among Protestants, there's two different views here, those who would be, quote unquote, affirming or revisionist. That there's the one view that St. Paul, Jesus, if they were alive today, would not condemn committed modern same-sex relationships. Our condemnation comes from a misinterpretation of their words. Then there's another view, which I think is closer to your view, which is that, oh, they would, but they would condemn them for the wrong reasons and for reasons that don't apply today.
Close. I would say
I try to get close to where I disagree with someone. I believe it's important to understand what someone believes before you set out to disagree with it.
Totally. I think Jesus being the incarnation of God probably would. I think my theological point is right, and I think Jesus would probably affirm it even 2,000 years ago.
Okay, so you would hold the view that Jesus is the divinity of Christ, fully God, fully man.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so St. Paul maybe not, because he is in a different cultural context, and we can dig into that later, but
all right.
Yeah.
Well, let's go through a little bit of the book and some of the arguments you make. So the book, now you've written several books. I see you brought another smaller one here. I don't know if that's an adaptation that went into this.
This was created to be a pamphlet to hand out to people. It's called Gay Christian No Contradiction.
I see. Yeah. So Gay and Christian No Contradiction is your earlier pamphlet. And then did that kind of turn into a book, The Gospel of Inclusion?
Yeah. Well, this actually came from my first book, Our Witness, which had my first shot at the theological argument. And then The Gospel of Inclusion is actually, I kind of cheat it with publication here. It's just my master's thesis that I put a cover on. So
that's quite all right. I'm someone who has, I have three master's degrees, so I've learned the art of repurposing content. That for me, I feel justified in doing that. If I wrote something for school and it's just sitting in a bin,
yeah,
and you know it's not doing anybody good, I have no problem repurposing that to.
Totally.
And if I have a duty, if it's got a good argument and you think you have a good argument, you should put it out there. What is the main thesis of your book?
So I kind of go through three different movements. The first movement that I be in all these conversations is, Jesus says that good theology, good Christian life will bear good fruit. And there's abundant evidence that says non-affirming, non-inclusive teaching produces psychological harm in people. So I always begin there because I think that's something most Christians don't know, and most pastors that are non-affirming don't know, that their theology actually has and has been studied to have psychological harm that increases suicidal ideation, increases youth homelessness. Mm-hmm. And so I spend a good portion in the three books I've written about this talking about that in the beginning. Then we jump into the clobber passages, and I kind of say, here's where I think the revisionist approach is good, and here's where I think it's a little weak. And then the main argument is that from Genesis to Revelation in the Bible, there's a consistent trajectory away from a patriarchal understanding of the world. So in the beginning of the Bible, you have Abraham and as the first patriarch and kind of establishing this patriarchal norm in scripture. Mm-hmm. But by the time we get to Jesus, we see Jesus acting in ways that was subverting what was understood both in the Hebrew world and the Greco-Roman world of what patriarchy should be. Jesus being a celibate man, that alone is a subversion generally of patriarchy. That was a very uncommon thing in first century Greco-Roman world, especially among Jewish people. Then by the time the way we see Jesus interacting with eunuchs and women and those who are taboo according to the religious tradition of the day is subtle subversions of patriarchy. And then by the time we get to the Apostle Paul, we start seeing this ethical and moral loosening that I believe goes across the spectrum from women in ministry to sexuality to how slaves are treated. And a lot of my argument came from an earlier book by an evangelical scholar, William Webb, called Slaves, Women, and Homosexuals.
Yeah, he wrote that back in 2001, another one I have in my office.
Right.
Right.
And I think his redemptive trajectory, that was so compelling to me to see.
Though Webb does not, he believes it applies to slaves and women, but he does not believe it applies to, so you would disagree with Webb, he doesn't think it applies to a loosening of morals on homosexuality.
Right. And I think, both Webb and a couple other scholars, we can talk about them later.
Sure.
I question their scholarship when it gets to the homosexual argument because it seems rather common sense that if you're using the argument, and most conservatives actually agree with me on this, that his argument against women or for women in ministry and against slavery, that same hermeneutical argument, if you're consistent and you apply to homosexuality, it should lead to the same conclusion. Women can be in all levels of church leadership, slaves should be liberated, homosexuals should be liberated.
Consistency is an interesting theme that comes out in the book. I mean, I don't want to jump too forward ahead. I want to go through the book systematically. But you made a passage in there that I thought is interesting, that there's always a lot of arguments. And what's funny is Andrew Sullivan, who is a man with same-sex attraction, married another man, but he's much more very conservative in his politics.
Right.
He once wrote an op-ed a while back saying to Christians, you know, if you're going to be against so-called same-sex marriage, then you need to go whole hog and be against no-fault divorce and be against these other things. And my thing has always been, if there is inconsistency, that consistency itself is not a virtue in and of itself, because you could be just consistent and wrong. You could just be a consistently wrong person. But for me, like you wrote in the book, you know, that there's a lot of Protestants who see no problem with non-procreative sex between men and women, oral sex, anal sex, divorce and remarriage. And I think you actually make a very compelling point there. But for me, it would go in the other direction.
Right.
Not that, well, we should endorse same-sex behavior, but that the opposite sex couples need to clean up their own backyards first.
Right.
So you see how where I could see that it's like, oh, you could go in one or two directions there.
And that's where I'll say, this will probably be the only time I'll say this, I think the Catholic Church is better than Protestants on this in the sense that the Catechism is really clear on all of these issues. I disagree, of course, with, I think, divorce and remarriage. I think we should have a more open approach to. But for the sake of moral consistency, I think the Catholic Church is an upper hand. And I think a lot of conservative evangelicals are now looking at the Catholic Church and saying, maybe we need to take that stance as well. And so you're seeing people like Dr. Albert Mohler of the Southern Baptist Convention saying, we need to take a firm stance on divorce. And if we have divorced people in our church, they're not going to be ministers anymore and all of that. So.
Right, because seeing you need to say what are the ultimate standards that you're using to make your theology. You're right, if it is just a kind of narrow reading of just a few Bible passages without an overarching worldview,
right,
then you can have these different consistencies. Let's go through the different arguments then that you make in the book. The first one is the argument from fruits, and this is a similar one that Matthew Vines also makes,
right,
that Jesus says, you shall know a tree by its fruits. And so a good tree can't bear bad fruit. This is in Matthew 7, 15 through 20. And also scripture refers to other things with false prophets and fruits and things like that. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs from thistles? So every sound tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears evil fruit. A sound tree cannot bear evil fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus, you will know them by their fruits. And to summarize what you said earlier, in the book, your argument is that teachings that say sexual behavior between two men or two women, teachings that say that is sinful, produce bad fruit because people who hear them are more likely to have mental illness or have suicidal ideation. And you think that's evidence that the teachings themselves are false.
Yeah, I think it cuts both ways. I would say that the non-affirming arguments do, every study that I list in there, and these are peer-reviewed academic studies that show conservative Christians just have a higher rate of having youth suicide, having youth homelessness, having youth mental illness among LGBT youth. And then the other side of it is gay Christians, people like me in my church, if you were to come down to San Diego and see our community, it's filled with people whose lives are being transformed by Jesus Christ, who are committing their lives to follow in the way of Jesus, who are seeking to conform their life to Scripture.
Right.
And when you see that, it's hard for me to have conservatives look at our church and say, well, that's bad fruit, because we're producing, I think, the same fruit that a conservative church who's sharing the gospel is.
Right. We are producing good fruit. How can you say our theology is wrong? Look at the effects of your theology. It's bad fruit. So there's a good fruit element and there's a bad fruit element. Let me address both of those. One, on the good fruit element, say, well, we believe even if our theology is incorrect, look at the fruits of the Holy Spirit we have: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness. The problem I have with that argument, I see that these fruits are necessary conditions, that if I see a church that completely lacks them, I'm going to question if it's Christian at all or if it has a sound theology. But I don't see it as a sufficient condition. They're mere presence, because you find these fruits even among non-Christian groups. You have atheists who get together who go out and do charitable work and have their own Sunday assemblies, and they can exhibit many of these, these fruits as well. But that doesn't mean their overlying theology or lack of theology is correct. It just may mean that God has blessed them and has chosen to work with the dispositions that they have. So that's why, for me, the good fruit argument is not as compelling. You see where I'm coming from here?
Right. I think it's because we have a theological difference here as well. I'm a universalist, so I believe we're all getting in. And I believe God is working not just through Christians or the Catholic Church or the Protestant Church, but through everyone always. And so I would say evidence of good fruit is, there's lots of theologians who have said that Christ is at work even with people who don't know that Christ is at work in them.
Sure.
And that's what I would argue on that side of things.
Right. So then for you, we're looking at theology. So as a universalist, you don't think that anyone will be eternally separated from God in hell.
Right.
And that, of course, that's a subject. Maybe I'll have you back on for that. I just had Randall Rouser on, who is a defender of conditional immortality, the idea that the damned are annihilated, but that hell does still exist. And so there's three views. There's the traditional view on hell, the annihilationist view, and then the universalist view. We haven't had that on the show yet. But here, just because someone has good fruit, that's no way for us to determine, because you would agree that atheists are incorrect about the existence of God, even if they're going to heaven.
Yeah.
So then their position on a theological question like, does God exist or not, would not be connected to the good fruit that they do. Their good fruit doesn't prove or disprove whether that theological position they hold is true or not.
Right. But ultimately, I believe that theology ultimately is humanity trying our best to speak of the unspeakable. As C.S. Lewis says, we're all aiming at the thing that we can never articulate or accurately describe. And so I'm thinking that all of our theology, I wouldn't say that the Catechism of the Catholic Church is completely correct. I think that's a group of people's best attempt to describe God. I think this is my best attempt to describe this particular issue and the way I understand God. But I think we're all falling short all of the time, and I think we're all going to be greatly surprised when we stand in the presence of God. Mm-hmm. And so my consistency is, I'm making this theological argument because I'm a Christian, because I'm in this tradition,
right?
But I wouldn't say Christianity holds the supreme corner on truth. I think it does for me. I think I want to bring people into it because it's what works for me and what has transformed my life, but I'm not willing to say that it's Christianity is the only way.
Yeah, well, it sounds like you're making more of a pragmatic argument then for why someone should be a Christian. If it works for you, become a Christian, but if not, don't worry about it.
Yeah, because I believe God is present in all things and Christ is present in all things. I'm mentored by Richard Rohr in his new book, Universal Christ. He talks very beautifully about how Christ is present in all different paths, all different people at all different times. And so I would lean in that direction.
And I would not lean in the direction of what Richard Rohr says. And that's, of course, for something for an entirely different podcast. But let's talk then about the bad fruit element here, because there's two things that I would disagree with you on. Well, first about the bad fruit, then about just this overall kind of argument that I think it's a misinterpretation of scripture. On the bad fruit end, just because a teaching or an action has, even if it has a negative effect, that in and of itself doesn't prove the teaching or action is false or bad. So for example, it's statistically proven that when people have higher rates of education, they're more likely to commit suicide. The more more society spends on education and values it, and the more people attain higher degrees, suicide rates tend to go up.
Sure.
That's not controversial. But that in and of itself would not prove that education is a bad thing. All it would prove is we've got some unfortunate connection between those who are intelligent and those who are well-learned and suicide that we have to find a way to mitigate somehow. Yeah. And so for me, even if it were the case that these teachings, when people hear them, they're likely to consider suicidal thoughts, that would just me show an unfortunate, unintended connection that we would have to try to mitigate. That wouldn't show the teaching is false.
Sure. And I mean, I would gently push back on it, but also say that this is not the foundation of the argument. The point of this argument is simply to say most Christian leaders aren't willing to grapple with our culpability in causing harm.
Oh, no. And so, I agree with you. Because, for example, if it is the case that homosexual behavior is not sinful, if it is the case, then people who preach that it is sinful do grave harm. I agree with you there.
I think I would even say, though, and this is, I mean, next week, for instance, I'm going to Miami and meeting with us off the record gathering of 10 evangelical pastors trying to talk to them to bring them to just this point.
What point?
This point, that if homosexuality is sinful, you still need to we need to be focused on harm reduction. I think it has more, this first argument is about the way we're communicating your message of a non-affirming theology that is actually harming people. And I hope my first step for any non-affirming community I'm working with is to reduce harm. So if we're, for instance, I do think the catechism's language is fundamentally harmful when they say homosexuality is intrinsically disordered. I was just reading the language.
2357. Right.
Yeah. Under no circumstances can it be approved. You know what it says. But it's really intense language that I think Pope Francis has done a great job of, at least in his statements, putting a little softer edge to what the church is trying to say.
But here's the thing, and maybe you can help me with this. The message I want to communicate with people is that it is a grave matter to use our sexual powers, if you will. That's the Thomist element to me. We talk about the natural powers that people have, and sexual powers are one of them, to misuse our sexuality and to engage in it outside of a marital context between a man and a woman. And those who do that risk their souls and risk eternal separation from God. So for me, like if I were you and held to the view that no one's going to hell, so there's that harm is off the table, and the only harms are negative psychological well-being in this life, then that view makes sense. But for me, how do I communicate? Because I'm not changing my mind about the fact that sexual sin can lead to eternal separation from God. How do I put that gently to people? I mean, I can put it. There's harsh ways you can talk to people, but sometimes some things are just harsh. Like if I tell somebody smoking causes lung cancer, and what lung cancer means is you're going to be coughing up blood and hacking up your lungs, and it's a horrible way to die, and I don't want you to get lung cancer. It's like I'm not a bad person for viscerally describing the consequence of smoking. Why would it be the case of the consequence of sexual sin?
Again, I think it's the case that I'm trying to make, at least in the first argument, because again, this is a passion point for me, is to say, I'm not necessarily saying that the argument itself leads to suicide. I think that's a really hard case to make in any field.
Sure.
But I am saying the way you communicate the argument can lead to mental distress. So if a preacher is getting in the pulpit and saying,
absolutely,
you're an abomination to God. Well, what is a youth supposed to do when their preacher and their parents are telling them that they're an abomination based on this thing that they didn't choose?
Right, and that's a stupid way to go about it. To say, and that's why for me, I don't use terms either gay, straight, LGBT, homosexual, or heterosexual.
Sure.
I don't like using those terms. I just say there are people who have same-sex attractions, people have opposite-sex attractions, and people who have multifaceted attractions. Might be a way to describe yourself. So that a person, like the word to'abah in the Old Testament refers to abomination, it refers to actions, not people. And I agree with you, there is a bit of hypocrisy where, and that's why another reason I gravitate to the Catholic Church, that we will have, you know, this anger towards one particular sin, but then if Frank divorces Jane and gets remarried, and we all act like it's not a big deal. I could see a homosexual teen, sometimes I use the terms, of course, for convenience yeah. and brevity, who sees that we treat one particular sexual sin differently than others.
Yeah.
Totally agree with that. That's going to create an undue psychological burden. But for me, the answer is just to be fair in our discussions, to distinguish people.
Yeah.
And I think this is where you and I might disagree. People made in the image and likeness of God and the attractions they have, whatever they may be.
Sure.
From the behaviors they voluntarily choose to engage in. And I think it's important to yeah. to separate those two things, to not get them too tightly wound up together.
As I'm thinking about it now, I don't think I necessarily disagree with that. One thing, this is, might be out of left field, but it's just something that I noticed on your comments of not wanting to talk about homosexual labels. It's interesting, though, that the Catechism uses that, which it says homosexual persons,
yes,
which seems to describe, in like the way us progressives talk about sexuality, it's they're identifying the person as homosexual, which I just found, I've never noticed that before, and it seems that's taboo in even conservative Protestant circles.
Yeah, there are some Catholic documents, some documents, the Catechism uses that language, which I think is unfortunate. There have been some other later ones, though, that actually make a point against that. So, for example, I'll bring this up here really quick. This is from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith.
Sure.
That's the highest teaching office representing the magisterium of the Catholic Church. It says this: the human person made in the image and likeness of God can hardly be adequately described by a reductionist reference to his or her sexual orientation. The church refuses to consider the person as a heterosexual or a homosexual. Even there, they use terms like the homosexual person
right.
to make not just a homosexual,
right.
which I think is even the church magisterial documents, the catechism don't just lump it in. Like, it's funny, you'll hear people in your own discourse say, well, the homosexuals, like, well, no one says the heterosexuals.
Oh, I say that. No, I'm kidding.
I mean, that would be like saying, you know, it's like what the blacks think. I'm like, that's not yeah. kosher. That's not kashrut. Yeah. So for me, the language that I use, I think it should be very person oriented. But I want to get to another point about the fruit argument yeah. that you and Matthew Fiennes used before we go on to the clobber passages.
Totally.
I think that this is a misunderstanding of what Jesus is trying to communicate in Matthew 7, 15 through 20, that the argument is not, you will know if a teaching is true or false based on the effects of the teaching, but rather you will know if a teacher
sure.
is valuable based on the teaching that they espouse. Because you could see someone that here you're talking, he's talking about false prophets, he's talking about teachers, and he uses this agricultural metaphor about yeah. Figs and thorns. The idea is you could see a tree or a brush, and it looks like it'll give you fruit. But you go up closer and you look at it, and the fruit it produces is inedible.
Yeah.
Much the same way you could see a teacher, someone who, you know, a Greek rhetorician or a yeah. or even a rabbi who's just always got all these people following him. And he seems so confident, like, oh, they're so winsome and affable. But then when you look at their teachings, the teachings give away
sure.
that they're a wolf in sheep's clothing. In fact, in 2 Peter 2:1-2, it says, false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their licentiousness, and because of them, the way of truth will be reviled. So for me, and no offense, yeah. but we can trade with each other, like I would see, like someone could look at you and say, you are, you know, you're young, you're intelligent, you're a good speaker. You seem like you're speaking the truth here. But then I look at the fruits that come from that, and, you know, not just the approval of sexual behavior between two people, but also openness to polyamory,
sure.
rejection of the existence of hell. That for me, like the passage is more for someone to say, well, this may be a charismatic teacher or preacher, but look at the teachings that flow from them. That
right.
you see where I'm coming from?
Yeah, and I don't disagree. I just think that argument cuts both ways because okay. I would just say the same thing back to the Catholic Church or to a non-affirming person and say, you're teaching something that looks good. You claim tradition that it's this is how it's always been, and yet I don't think that the teaching is bearing the fruits based on my interpretation of scripture, my understanding of the context, that the fruit that it's bearing is good fruit. And I still would point back to look throughout history of the oppression, suppression, and harm done to LGBT people throughout the history of Christianity. And I think...
Sure. And that's why the Catechism says in paragraph 2358, for example, that those who have same-sex attraction should not be the victims of unjust discrimination.
Sure.
So, for example, in one of my books, I tell a story about, it's like 30, 40 years ago, back when the AIDS crisis was first unfolding, and there was a religious house with nuns that was treating AIDS patients in Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And there were people who were protesting at the time, you know, thinking like, what if we get AIDS? Like, why are you treating these people? Why would you do something like this in our community?
Yeah.
And the religious sister said, well, these are human beings, being in the image and likeness of God. We're going to be there for them in their final hour. So for me, there's one example, and I know there's Christians who would disagree with that. And so I would say, in joining with someone like you, that they're wrong. That, you know, someone right. who identifies as gay or lesbian, who is suffering from some kind of disease and needs medical treatment or needs housing
yeah.
or needs a basic necessity of life, that we have a duty to provide it. Just as Jesus challenged people in his time to provide, you know, the Samaritan who provided right. for his enemy, the Judean. So, yeah. I forget where I was going with this, yeah. but you see where I'm coming from.
Totally, and that's just again the point of that argument is hopefully to be more of a unifying point right at the beginning, is to say, even though we might disagree about how the actual interpretation plays out, I think we can both agree that harm being done to LGBT people by the church being doing unjust actions or being overtly harsh for no good reason
sure.
Is something that we should all stand against. And
I firmly agree with you.
Yeah.
Where I would put the line down is I would say that the teaching itself can't be construed as being that which is the villainous force here if it turns out to be true. So, for example, right. I've gone to talks where I've done talks on, you know, so-called same-sex marriage, LGBT plus issues. And people have said, you know, you offended me with your talk. What you said offended me.
Right.
And so I said, okay, how could I share my message in a way that would not offend you? Just please, because if I used a word that was inappropriate, a slur, I'll happily delete that from my vocabulary. And then she said, well, you should just say that if two people love each other, that's all that matters. I said, well, but that's not my message.
Yeah.
So how do I communicate my message without offending you? And she said, well, I guess you can't. And I said, okay, so then it's not really about me. It's we yeah. got to figure out if this teaching is true or not. So let's go then, as Christians, we look to the Bible, though, you know, Protestants and Catholics, even among Protestants, different views
yeah.
about the authority of the Bible, but we still go and look there.
Totally.
And this will help. And then I almost wish we had Vines here to have, it's almost such a distinct view
yeah.
from yours. And maybe I will have him or someone else on and it'll be a very different conversation. Because people, a lot, even people who are, you know, Catholics who are listening to this, who've held with us now for 40 minutes or yep. wherever, they say, well, look at the Bible. It's just, it's obvious, isn't it? It's just obvious from the Bible. And let's go to those passages. I'm going to briefly hopscotch over, I think it's Genesis 19, about yep. the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. Because there, that's not the most helpful story for us to determine
right.
if sexual behavior between two men or two women is immoral.
Totally.
My position would just be, at the very least, the element of homosexual activity in the story was meant to add another layer of depravity to it. So that's
sure.
that's the position that I'll take. That's not one that'll push us in either direction. But I think going forward for the Old Testament witness, the passages in Leviticus 18:22 and Leviticus, I think it's 20:13,
yeah.
are ones that get brought up a lot. In fact, what's funny is I notice a lot of Christians will go to Leviticus first before they go to
yeah.
Romans or 1 Corinthians 9 through 10. So I'll just read the first Levitical passage, which is simple. You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. And that's part of the purity codes in Leviticus 18, dealing with incest and other grave sexual behaviors. Leviticus 20:13 repeats the same thing. If a man lies with a male as with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall be put to death. Their blood is upon them, which, of course, makes reference to many other grave violations of Old Testament Levitical law that also carried with it the death penalty.
Right.
Your thoughts on these passages?
Again, preface at the beginning, I don't think these arguments are the most convincing arguments, but I'll give you the arguments that I would still hold to.
These are the other revisionist arguments.
Right.
Okay.
And I think Leviticus is an interesting passage. It's one that I think probably has the strongest case that the author of Leviticus meant what he said when homosexuality is an abomination. But I think what we need to understand is that the context that the author is talking about is not the same as what we're talking about in modern day. In Leviticus, the cultures that surrounded the ancient Hebrew people, these were cultures that offered sexual sacrifices to gods and goddesses, sure, as a form of worship. The Bible talks about that pretty explicitly. And so the homosexual acts that God is calling the Hebrew people out of and away from is to distinguish them from those people, those false teachers, those false people that are worshiping false gods, and not to engage in these exploitive practices of a lot of the homosexual acts that were happening were between older men and younger boys, things that we would call pedophilia today, mm-hmm, or pederasty. And so I think the author of Leviticus is condemning something based on his culture that looks nothing like what we're talking about today. I think that's the first argument there. Then the other one is kind of the broader Christian argument, is that these passages are part of Levitical law, which almost no Christian still upholds because of Paul's teachings, that grace has now pulled us away from the law. And Paul and Peter debate it quite a bit about whether Christians should adhere to the ancient laws of the Hebrew Bible or whether we're freed from doing that. Mm-hmm. And I think Paul wins the day with his arguments in the New Testament saying, no, you're not required to be circumcised. You're not required to follow dietary laws. These things are all passed away. And Leviticus passage falls in the midst of condemnations that are all part of that culturally defined Jewish purity law.
Let's go. I'll address both of those revisionist points. So the first one being, I'll agree with you that many sexual encounters between two men in the ancient, among the ancient Israelites, among those pagan cultures, and even the Greco-Roman world, would have been young men and boys, what we would call pederasty, though not necessarily exclusively. Right. That there's still a lot of evidence from ancient Mesopotamian records of adult men engaged in homosexual behavior with each other, especially if it is a superior in the social hierarchy and an inferior, and we'll probably talk about that with patriarchy, but that would be something still involving adults. And that the passages in Leviticus, I think that they apply, I think you'll probably see the strength of this, the author of Leviticus is enjoining all kinds of these relationships for everyone, both Jews and Gentiles. First, there's no distinction about that this is merely dealing with cultic offerings. Like the author of Leviticus talks about child sacrifice to Molech, for example. He doesn't talk about same-sex behavior as part of any particular fertility cult or anything like that. Second, the one for me that's more stronger evidence that it had a universal scope was that this is a part of, it says in two verses later in verse 24, do not defile yourselves by any of these things, for by all these the nations I am casting out before you defiled themselves, and the land became defiled so that I punished its iniquity, and the land vomited out its inhabitants. Mm-hmm. The sin here is put next to bestiality, it's put next to cases of incest.
Right.
That the author of Leviticus sees this as something serious that Gentiles could be held accountable for, whereas they would not be held accountable for violations of the kosher law.
Sure.
That it's something he would see is that even they, it was so grave, they're vomited out of the land because they're doing this. Well, I guess I'll add one more thing and then you could comment on. But I mean, you would agree that those who say, well, this is part of Leviticus, some Levitical laws still carry over today. You know, the prohibitions on bestiality, on adult incest, on adultery, on... and then, of course, economic justice also carries over from Leviticus.
Sure.
So the question, I always don't like that response like, oh, well, that's in Leviticus. Well, some of it still carries over. Now, I didn't mean to clobber you with a bunch of my response, but take as much as you want. We can go back and forth.
Right. I just think just because Leviticus has some good things in it that we still would adhere to, I don't think that means that the Levitical law needs to be... I don't think almost any Christian theologian would say Levitical law carries over necessarily to apply to Christians today. Yeah, I think also putting it in the context of BCL and other things is a good point to say that this isn't the same kind of behavior we're talking about today. Bestiality wasn't just something done in the ancient world for fun. It was done out of severe depravity, and it was done out of, more often than not, false religious worship and false religious cultic practices. And so when you see homosexuality grouped within that, and then I think, not to jump ahead, but I think Romans 1 also shows Paul's thinking about this passage and puts homosexuality in a list of false worshiping of gods. He says, you've worshiped created things instead of the creator God. You worship images of reptiles. And then homosexual behavior emerges among other sorts of behavior. So I think if that's how Paul's interpreting Leviticus, and I think it is, then we can see that it all begins with this false worshiping of false gods. This is all in the context of idolatry.
But also these other false, these other pagan deities. So the argument to catch our listeners up to speed is that some revisionists will say Leviticus is condemning pagan sexuality, but not necessarily homosexuality per se. And so the idea here is that you're nodding a little bit like, okay, I'm willing to.
I don't like the word pagan. I know the Bible uses it because it's such a weird word. It's
Gentile. Gentile.
Even, I mean, I think Leviticus is condemning very specific behavior about very specific cultures that were surrounding this very small group of people.
Sure. We'll call it Canaanite then.
Sure.
But even in the Canaanite cultures, their deities, for example, routinely practiced incest. And so that was a justification for the Canaanites to engage right. in incest as well. Yet it wouldn't follow, therefore, that we don't have problems with incest today, since people who engage in incest are not doing it to satisfy Baal or something like that. That just because it may have been associated with that, for the Levitical author, it was still a grave departure from the creation norm that God originally gave.
But I think the important thing is that what I'm talking about, at least when we're talking about these passages, is what the author meant in his time, not how we're interpreting it today. I think the author, in his context, in his time, had these things in mind, these false practices of cultures around him, and he's writing to a group of people in the midst of that, talking about that. And we might extrapolate it, and we might have even early Christian theologians taking this and applying it. But I'm saying, if we get down to just the academic side of what is the cultural context of Leviticus.
But even if we do that, like if you have someone like William Loder, probably one of the premier scholars today when it comes to homosexuality in the ancient world, would hold to the view that this author would have seen that even in non-cultic contexts, that if you just had two Israelites sneaking off to, you know, Brokeback Sinai Mountain, whatever it might be, if they did that, that would fall. Sorry, but I mean, but you think about it, like where would these things happen? You have people who are just off on their own, alone.
Yeah. That he would
still condemn those kinds of behaviors.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, I don't think I would necessarily agree or disagree with that, because I think based on his cultural context, his time, the way ethics and morals were being understood in this time period, I think. Generally, if you saw two men having sex in the ancient world during this time period, it would have been condemned by the Hebrew people, which is why I think, and I've said before, Leviticus is the weakest argument for revisionists to talk about, because I think I think the author meant what he said likely at the end of the day.
Let's then go on to there's different kinds of passages, and we'll come back to this here, because we can go talk about Paul, because you have the passages in Leviticus, you have the passages in Paul, but also I think for me the more important ones are the passages in Genesis 1 and 2 and Matthew 19 when Jesus is talking about his ethic on divorce and remarriage. So maybe we'll get to that third, because we've got the command provides an overarching paradigm for us to understand how sexuality is God gave it to us versus where the don'ts are. Because there's one argument I hear a lot. I saw it a little bit in your book, and I think it's one of the weakest arguments of the revisionist view. And that is that homosexual behavior is not condemned often. You know, you have five condemnations that saying because it's condemned infrequently, it was not a big deal. To me, that argument doesn't really carry any weight, because you have some sins that are grievous that are rarely condemned, like child sacrifice. That would be a preeminent one right there, for example.
Sure.
That just because sometimes a sin does not have to be repeated, because it just becomes obvious for people.
Yeah, I think I would disagree with it in the same way you're articulating it. I would disagree that just because it's not mentioned a lot, it's not a sin. But I would say when we get to the New Testament and like the arguments about Jesus and Paul and Peter and the writers of the New Testament not speaking of it much, we do know homosexuality and homosexual behavior was much more prevalent in the Greco-Roman world than it was in the ancient Hebrew world. That we do know, N.T. Wright talks about this, that there were homosexual relationships in the first century in the Greco-Roman world that Paul would have known about, that Jesus would have known about, and the fact
but not necessarily in first century Palestine. There's a difference between Corinth, Rome, and Ephesus, and being in Jerusalem and the context there. You're not going to have people in Corinth rioting to get rid of blasphemous shields like they did in Jerusalem when Pontius Pilate put them up. So for me, it makes sense that Paul explicitly talks about same-sex behavior and incest.
Sure.
And that Jesus doesn't talk about either of those things, as they weren't as big a problem in the immediate context in Jerusalem and Galilee.
I'll grant you that argument.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I do believe that Jesus was addressing, we'll get to Jesus. Paul, we'll be right there with you. Because we're moving forward. And I think that it's important. A lot of people, when they talk about this, they just go to Leviticus and they go to Romans and Corinthians.
Yeah.
For me, this is the important area here, that when Jesus was asked to weigh in on a sexual, on a dispute about sexual morality,
he was
asked to weigh in, the thing that was debated was the issue of divorce and the issue of remarriage, two different things. Whether it was lawful to divorce your wife, could you do it? You know, there was the great dispute between the rabbinical houses of Hillel and Shammai. Could you, well, only for adultery. Well, actually, you could do it if she burns your dinner, you know. And so then Jesus takes a view even beyond them. He says, you cannot divorce, you know, you cannot divorce your spouse. Remarriage makes them an adulterer, except in cases of unchastity. And that's a whole different trail for us to go down. But I noticed in your book, you talked about, well, let's go to the Gospel of Mark, because it's very reliable to know what Jesus said. And there in Mark 10, there's no exception clause. Jesus, the tradition about divorce that's preserved there, is just, let's bring it up, because I think that weighs in on the ethics that we use. So Mark chapter 10, he says, Mark 10:11-12, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. And, you know,
period.
And he grounds that before, when he's asked about divorce, you know, Moses allowed it. Yeah, that was for your hardness of hearts. There is a trajectory in scripture, you know, to borrow from you, moving away from that the ideal, and St. Thomas Aquinas said that his argument for why the concession was allowed in the Old Testament was to prevent wife murder. That was his argument. Why did God allow divorce in the Old Testament? Hmm. Well, it's because God in his wisdom foresaw that people would have such hard hearts, if they couldn't divorce their wives, they would just end up murdering them.
Yeah.
Because in order to be convicted of murder, you need two or three witnesses.
Yeah.
And you're often alone with your spouse and you just push them over a cliff and you marry a concubine or whatever. But Jesus says, it's not from the beginning. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man put asunder.
Sure.
So for me then, we have, if we looked and you believe Jesus is fully divine, we can trust the ethics we receive from Jesus. He takes a very firm view on sexual ethics that restricts it to monogamous marriage between a man and woman. So how do we get a wider sexual ethics from someone like Jesus when he seems pretty clear?
I think the weakness of that argument is just, again, extrapolating out of this a full sexual ethic. I would agree that the ethic Jesus is articulating here, and one that I would preach at my church, is that covenant relationship is the core of what Jesus is getting at. When you commit your life to another person in marriage, that is a binding contract before God and before man, and that you should honor that contract. And so I would likewise lean against and caution people against divorce 9 times out of 10. Now we can get into grace and how Paul uses grace ethically later, and that's where I would apply grace if there were divorced folks in my congregation. I'm not going to bar them from communion or anything like that, but I think that,
well, I wouldn't, for me, I would not, someone who is divorced in the Catholic Church can receive communion if they've been divorced against their will, it's not their fault. Two, if they have committed the sin of divorce and abandoned their family, you can repent of that.
Yeah.
For me, the problem is if someone, Jesus says that those who continue in remarriage after divorce of a valid marriage, they continue in adultery. And the Bible seems pretty clear that adultery is a sin. Yet for you yourself saying you're open to polyamory, it sounds like you're saying adultery is okay if you have their permission.
I don't think polyamory... First of all, I want to be very clear. I don't want to be pigeonholed as the polyamory pastor. This whole thing publicly came about because...
Well, I mean, it's in your book.
Right. Yeah. And the reason it's in the book is because it came about. We didn't ask anything serious at our church where people could submit questions. One thruple submitted a question and said, we've been a group of three people. Yes. We've been in a committed relationship for a number of years. We go to your church. What do you say to us? And I said... We call you to the same sexual ethics as everybody else, that in your committed relationship, you need to be committed to each other. You need to live out the same sexual ethics we call everyone to and be faithful to each other. And you're welcome here. Mm-hmm. Because I think it's a really hard case to make. And I would argue this really strongly, that the number of people in relationships is in the Bible fluctuates. You see people having different sorts of relationships. Polygamy is certainly blessed throughout scripture.
Well, I wouldn't say that it's blessed. It's something that's recorded. throughout the Old Testament. The closest you can come is that when David is rebuked for his shenanigans with Bathsheba, yeah. God speaking through Nathan the prophet says, I gave you the whole kingdom. I gave you everything in Israel. I gave you all of the king's all these wives. I gave you all this stuff. And yet you still had to help yourself to Bathsheba. But otherwise, when you look at the Old Testament, I would further that trajectory element you're talking about, that the trajectory is moving away from it, that's another, right. Just like divorce in the Old Testament, that there we have a toleration for the hardness of hearts, for a common practice. And I would say that in Mark 10 and Matthew 19, when Jesus closes the loophole on divorce and remarriage, some of the rabbis had allowed, he did the same with polygamy.
And also, I agree. So in my patriarchy argument, mm-hmm. I think polygamy is sinful and wrong because it's usually an exploitive relationship of one man over many women. People misunderstand what polyamory is. And again, I don't want to be pegged as this is
we
not
can,
the...
But we can yeah. talk about it. Because for me, if someone's right about sexual ethics, even if it seems absurd to me, I'm yeah. willing to listen because there was a time when Catholic sexual ethics seemed absurd to me.
Sure.
But I was willing to listen and hear it out and I changed my mind.
Yeah.
So you're right that you have polyamory is... romantic and sexual attraction with more than one person at the same time.
Usually in the context of a committed relationship. So this isn't...
There's a lot of people who say they're in open relationships.
But that's not polyamory. That's different. So there are open relationships, there's polyamory, there's swinging relationships.
Okay, then we'll call... Okay, there's non-monogamy.
But I wouldn't even say that, other than mono meaning one. Polyamorous would be polygamy. It's... Most people that I've met, for instance, Reverend Rochelle Brown, who just was the former moderator of Metropolitan Community Churches, has been in a relationship with her two wives for, I think, a decade. They have kids together. They're living together. It's a committed relationship. This isn't a sexually deviant thing where they're going out and having sex with whoever they want to do. They're committed in a relationship.
But here's the interesting. So you've got a standard, and I think, and don't worry, Paul, we'll get to you here soon. you'll make an appearance here because of 1 Corinthians chapter 5. You agree that as Christians, it's possible to fall into sexual sin.
Sure.
But then we have to figure out where do our standards for sexual sin come from? And it seems like you're returning to just one standard, which is sexual behavior is okay within a committed relationship.
I think commitment is the highest part of sexual ethics, but you're not going to like where I'm going to go with how I deal with sexual ethics, because I do center around Paul's Romans 14 argument that there are lots of these ethics there are lots of ethical principles that are, I don't think are universal. I think are individual ethics. I think we have standards that inform how this looks individually. So we center around a group of values, but the way those values are lived out look differently in each context and person's life. So the way we do sexual ethics is to say commitment is key. Covenant is key.
Why is it? Because for example, like with food and drink, like I don't have to have a committed relationship with those I choose to buy food from or eat with. I can eat what I want, where I want, when I want. Why does sex require commitment for it to be holy? Whereas you can't have things like open relationships or sex can't be casual for Christians. What's the warrant for that?
Well, I wouldn't say that sex can't necessarily be casual for Christians. So, but I would say...
Well, you can't unring the bell right there. Because I know your book also talks about that...
Premarital sex is not sinful.
Yeah. So then there, what kind of... then tell me, how do I determine if a sexual behavior is sinful or not?
Again, I think this is an in my theological view, I think theology is given to us to help us be healthy and whole people, not to not offend God. And so I think this is where I've shifted in my view from what I had as a traditional evangelical theology.
But we could offend God, though, with things that we do. Like if we mistreat ourselves or act in irrational ways, like that would offend him.
But I think that God gives us laws so that we can be healthy, we can be holy, and we can be whole.
Sure.
That's what God is pushing us towards. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about sexual ethics, when I talk about relationships, I'm saying commitment is the key to relationships. I'm not going to put a flag in the sand on either side of this, and people have tried to nail me down, and I don't think you can, because I hold, again, this Romans 14 ethical bent, which says, Romans 14 essentially says, what is sin for one person may not be sin for another, so let us not judge anyone. And
well, let's go to that, because yeah. I would say that that's not what Romans 14 says. Here, Paul is talking about judgment, particularly in aspects of food and drink, that the two biggest things that were dividing Christians in the early church was whether the question is, to become a good Christian, do you have to be a good Jew? Do you have to? And so you look
and
at the
uphold Levitical laws.
Right. Well, what it means to be a good Jew. So you have people, and that's why I appreciate the new perspective on Paul arguments from people like N.T. Wright, E.P. Sanders, James Dunn. And some of them have said their view on Paul is actually kind of pretty similar to the Catholic view, which is that Paul was concerned about people saying that you have to belong to the Jewish people as part of a badge of honor or national identity before you could become a Christian, which means being circumcised and which means upholding the dietary laws, so that no Gentile could become a Christian. You'd have to be a Jew first, which would severely inhibit the universal gathering of all people in the body of Christ if everyone had to become a Jew. He says, as for the man who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not for disputes over opinions. One believes he may eat anything, while the weak man eats only vegetables. Let not him who eats despise him who abstains. Let not him who abstains pass judgment on him who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the master is able to make him stand. So I would agree that Paul is saying, and in Colossians he also says, you want to have festivals, new moons, Passover, fine. You want to retain some of your Jewish holidays, fine. You don't want to, that's okay. But he also makes clear in other passages, like when the Corinthians were saying, all things are lawful to me, and, you know, they're slaves to their bellies, that he makes it clear that food and sex are very, very different. Like in the case of 1 Corinthians chapter 5, he expels someone from the community for engaging in a committed relationship with was probably his stepmother. We don't know if the father was alive or not at that time, but I'd question
the committed relationship part there.
Why?
I don't think Paul says that it's a committed relationship. Well, I think this guy's having sex with his stepmother, and that's a sinful action.
Why is it a sinful action?
I think I would go to a simple biological argument to say having sex with another stepmother here is where I'm going to fall off here.
But that's the problem, because when we look at it, it doesn't say it's his mother. It says it's his father's wife in 1 Corinthians 5.
Yeah.
So
I think it's that part is ambiguous, but I do think, again, there is a standard. I think Genesis gives us a standard of two people coming together in covenant committed relationship. I think that's what we're calling people to when they enter into covenant relationship. This guy having sex with his father's wife. From what I can understand, that doesn't sound to me, and I have not done study on that particular passage, that doesn't sound like a committed relationship between two equals in a relationship.
But it sounds like to me that what you're, and I've seen this before when I read arguments and I, you know, peruse, I was perusing I think it was Perez Hilton, actually. He's a self-identified gay blogger. Not Paris Hilton, ladies and gentlemen, Perez Hilton, self-identified gay blogger. You know, I widely peruse the blogosphere to see what the haps are. As my father-in-law would say, what are the haps? And he was sharing a story about adult incest. And people were like, just the comments, like, this is gross, this is disgusting. But I noticed there were a few commenters who said, hey, wait a minute, guys, isn't this the same thing people tell us all the time?
Sure.
And so it just seems like you're just like when you hear about this case, you're operating from that similar gut instinct that the traditionalists argue when they hear about same-sex intercourse.
I disagree there. I don't think it's just it's not the ick argument, as I would call it, which I think is I think you think it's probably a weak argument. Just because you're not attracted to something doesn't mean that it's right or wrong.
Right.
However, I do think that there are standards that all humans have had at all times, and incest has generally been condemned across human history. Rape of children has been generally condemned across human history.
Sure, and I think the question here is, and most people would agree that intergenerational incest, a father preying on his minor children, for example, there's a severe power imbalance, there's that sex with children in general, obviously, is wrong. Though I would ask the deeper question, why it's wrong. And the reason I would say why is because children, those prior to puberty, because obviously in the ancient world, people who are 13, 14 were entering into marriages. You're entering, even as young men, you're entering into adulthood before you reach the age of 18 because you had to survive.
Yep.
And that those were considered valid, lawful, moral marriages.
Totally.
But prior to puberty, when you have someone who's like child brides, like 9, 7, 6, you have human beings who are not ordered towards the procreative end of marriage yet. They have not simply developed properly to reach that particular end. So that's a clear sign they're not suitable marriage partners. But then for me, that feeds us back into that kind of Genesis creation narrative. The same as when you say, well, it's clear the Bible gives us that it's two people. Well, I would say, well, why is it two? You know, well, male, female would explain that. But, I mean, then that would also seem to undercut your figurings on polyamory too.
Well, so here's the thing. My problem with the Genesis argument is I think Catholics are great at this and I get the appeal of this, but a lot of this is symbolic and we put too much stock in the symbolism to translate into literal reality. So I don't think Genesis 1 and 2 is literal history. I think it's a poetic musing about how the world was created.
Well, I use the term epic poetry.
Great.
But I do believe there are specific literal truths that are communicated.
And I think we would probably disagree. Like, I don't think Adam and Eve were historical people. I don't think that's how the world works. I think science tells us that's not how the world began and how humans emerged on planet Earth. But I think there is a truth trying to be communicated through Genesis 1 and 2. And when we take it literally or we infuse it with literal meaning and or take the symbols that are being communicated and the stories that are being communicated and make that law for all people at all times, I think we do a great injustice both to what the text was trying to do. And
well,
we're imposing...
Well, what do you think Jesus was trying to do with it in Matthew 19? He appeals to it, and then he prohibits remarriage after divorce.
Right. So I think, again, so Jesus is talking to a specific person in a specific context, talking about marriage between a man and a woman. That was the question posed to him.
Right.
So he's answering that question. But I think what we should do, and how I interpret Scripture, how I teach Scripture, is I'm looking at these individual statements that have been made in particular contexts and stories and saying, what is the principle being communicated here? And using that principle for our modern teaching as Christians. And so the principle I see there is covenant commitment. Jesus is saying the problem here is with divorce is that you've made a commitment with God and people, and now you're breaking that commitment. And so I condemn that. And I think he's answering that question that way, using the context of the male and female that are being brought in that particular story.
Well, but it seems to be a particular kind of covenant commitment. Like the language of one flesh is not used when it comes to things like adoption, which occurs frequently in the Old Testament.
In the New Testament, it kind of is.
Well, where the term one flesh?
I would say, I mean, spiritual adoption into Christ. Paul talks a lot about us becoming one body, one flesh.
He doesn't say that we become one flesh with Christ. He talks about that we're one body and that we're all united under the grace of God. But that term, that they become one flesh, seems it's very specific of a kind of bond that for me, that's not poetic. That what it means to be one flesh, to be unified, a union only exists when two incomplete parts come together ordered towards something beyond them as a whole.
So you believe that a man is incomplete without a woman?
He's incomplete when it comes to the goal of marriage and procreation. Yes, because, for example, all my reproductive systems are fully actualized in my own body except for one, and that would be the reproductive system. It does not meet its end it's naturally designed for without another person. But I can eat by myself, I can breathe by myself, but I can't reproduce by myself. So I do believe there is an incompleteness there in that sense.
Right. And this is, again, and we're kind of going down this rabbit hole, but within the Catholic Protestant traditions, we have this differing theology of, again, I wouldn't say sex is primarily meant for procreation. And I would say that male-male, female-female, male-female, all of those work together in a beautiful way, and we don't have to get into the anatomy.
Well, what would you say? This is another basic question I ask people. What would you say sex is for? What has been revealed to us, or what would you say sex is for?
I think procreation is a purpose of sex. I also think sex is a unifying act in a relationship. It deepens relationships. It's an expression of love. It's an expression of pleasure in a relationship. And so when I hear people articulate what sex is to them, you actually rarely hear that it's meant to just primarily be procreative.
And I don't say that it's solely for that. Like my answer to the question is it's an expression of marital love.
Right.
And that's a particular union that is achieved not just on an emotional level, but it's also on a biological level.
Right. And I would argue from that perspective that chemically what's happening in sex is you're binding a relationship closer and closer together hormonally. All of these things are happening. It's beautiful. And so sex is meant to be connective. It's meant to be joining people together. And in the context of relationship, it becomes sacramental. And I would agree, we probably have different definitions of what sacramentality
is. Yes,
looks
and
like.
The Catholic Church has sacramental marriage is a valid marriage between a baptized Christian man and a baptized Christian woman.
And I talk about sacrament as communicating God's grace or a mystery of God in a physical action on earth. And so in sex, when you have a committed covenant relationship in marriage and sex is taking place in that, there is this beautiful sacramental nature of God being expressed and God's grace and beauty being expressed in that. I would agree, and I think you probably agree, probably with differing on terms and language, but
right, that how it's communicated at as a sacrament is that it unites a man and woman towards the goals of the Catholic Church believes there's two purposes of marriage: is procreative and unitive, to form an actual union. So, for example, the Church has never formally condemned marriage between people who are sterile or sexual relations during pregnancy, for example. But when you divorce those two ends, that's where it becomes disordered. While we still have a little bit of time left, and we could go on and on forever, but we'll keep going. What's nice is I had a chat with my supporters of the podcast, and we came to the conclusion we should let these dialogues go as long as they feel like. Just divide them up into 30-minute episodes so our listeners will know. But I'll release them all at once because you've got your drive time segments to bite. Why don't we talk about some more of the clobber passages, and then maybe we can wrap it up here more, because we only briefly touched on what Paul was saying, and also, you know, so we're taking this from Jesus. Well, I don't know. I want to go back to Jesus. I don't know. Because
I want to, too.
Yeah, because, here's my thing. It sounds like you're saying that if sex is for a committed committed relationship, it's bonding, it's love, then why would Jesus care if you have that with somebody else after you've divorced a spouse? It seems to be more than just forming a commitment. Or Paul, why not have this kind of great relationship with your stepmother? You know, if you're both adults and you're now closer together to one another, I don't see the Bible teaching us that is what sex is for.
I just think that I think that you're reading more into what Jesus is saying there. I think he's addressing a specific question in a specific time and giving a specific answer based on his understanding of Jewish law. And he's saying, hey, he was asked about a man and a female getting divorced, and he said, a man shall leave his father and a...
But he doesn't side with Hillel or Shammai. He takes an extreme view for the most extreme view for his day. That
sure, and he does that often in a lot of his ethical things. I agree, and I say in the book, he's raising ethical standards. I believe that.
Then should we meet that standard and say, for example, that remarriage after divorce constitutes adultery? If that's, to me, it just seems like he's saying what he's saying.
I don't disagree with what he's saying. I think you can press me, and I'm not a scholar on divorce and remarriage. I haven't thought through that as much as I probably should. But what I would say is I do think I agree and side with Jesus. I say in a covenant relationship, it's really important that two people are committing to each other and that they honor a covenant that they make, and that you shouldn't enter into a covenant relationship with someone lightly, which I do think is a big problem in our world today and in the church today. So I would side with Jesus on what he's saying there. The question is whether it's, if he's trying to clearly articulate that it has to be between one man and one woman, or if he's communicating that covenant is what is important.
But I think for me, because the thing is, the question would naturally become, why does a covenant relationship have to be lifelong or permanent, or something that can only be dissolved by death, which is what he's articulating here for marriage? Because you can have covenant with other family members. I mean, you see that with adoption, with families coming together, things like that in the Bible. And family might be a little bit more, we understand somewhat of the lifelong nature, but even there, people can disown their children in scripture. Right. Prodigal son goes off and, you know, well, he's no longer my son anymore. They're not my people anymore. They've abandoned me. But to me, the question is, why is covenant commitment permanent? To me, it seems that Jesus goes back to Genesis because it's part of the created order that's unique to men and women. Why God made them to be formed into one flesh. And that's also something that even like the Essenes in Jesus' time also appealed to that same kind of reasoning.
Yeah. I would say, I don't think all covenant is until death. I think marriage is a unique covenant that throughout most cultures and most times, I do know that the general marital vow has been pretty much the same. And it is this two people coming together and saying death to do us part.
Right.
If you make that covenant, then you've made the covenant till death do you part. This is weird and off in left field, but I suppose if people made commitments to say, I'm committing to do life with you for 6 months, it would be a different kind of covenant than the covenant that we're making in marriage.
Okay, so you're saying that something intrinsic to marriage is that it's lifelong.
Well, yes, I think like if that's the vow you're verbally making during marriage, right, then that's the vow.
But then you're saying if someone says, I promise to love and honor you, and there's people who've talked about this, renewable marriages. I promise to love and honor you. And we'll figure it out in 3 years when it's up for renewal. I think you would say that's not really marriage.
Well, see, I think I might we might disagree on this too. I don't think marriage is a thing unto itself that exists somewhere. Like, there's nothing nothing objective called marriage that exists. I think marriage is what we call a covenant when two people enter into a relationship, typically for a lifelong relationship. And so I get
When they enter, but it has to be a particular kind of relationship. So, for example, if I choose to adopt a child and they'll always be my child, we've entered into a lifelong covenant relationship, but that's not marriage.
Well, yeah, because marriage has the relational, the love component, the coming together.
It has the sexual component.
Not necessarily.
Well, if I adopt a child, I'm going to love them for the rest of my life and their life.
But there are also plenty of marriages where sex doesn't happen.
Well, you mean marriages where there's impotency or where there's...
There's so many reasons why a couple couldn't have sex.
Well, even... Are you familiar with the work of John Corvino?
Yeah.
Okay, so John Corvino is a self-identified gay man married to another man, probably one of the best arguers for so-called same-sex marriage. And I use that term because I believe marriage has a specific meaning to it.
Sure.
For me, if marriage is just the union of two adults, you could put any prefix in front of it you want, almost. But if it's definitionally about men and women, same-sex in front of it becomes a contradiction. So Corvino is asked often, you know, well, what is marriage? And he has a very wonderful philosopher's definition. He says, it is a relationship involving more than one person where sex is permissible.
I like it and I don't like it, but yeah.
Well, I mean, but even notice that I think it makes sense that everyone agrees marriage, that even just the permissibility of it, we see like it's something where we wouldn't be surprised if married people have sex.
No, but I don't, I have a really hard time and I don't see how you're getting there to say that sex is the thing that makes marriage marriage. That feels strange to me. And the other question, just this is my question to you.
Sure.
Where scripturally, like this, because I've heard a lot of Catholic apologists talk about this thing called marriage that exists, other than pulling it out of Genesis and saying, giving it this title marriage and boxing it up, which is all non-scriptural, like, where are you getting this idea that marriage is a thing that exists somewhere and it's a standard that's out there that God has created definitionally?
Well, we get part of that from scripture, but Catholics, of course, don't follow, you know, we don't believe in sola scriptura. We don't believe in scripture alone, that there are many things that have been taught, you know, that are true that are not explicitly revealed in scripture. In fact, the New Testament doesn't even record people being married in a church, for example, doesn't record that. It doesn't answer the question of whether the children of believers have to be baptized if they're born of a holy marriage. We have that from sacred tradition, but also just from, I would just say, from natural law, that we understand there's certain kinds of relationships that, well, the Bible is not a philosophy book. You and I, it's not a textbook.
Yeah.
It's a story of God's revelation to man and man's response to God. And so here I would say that, putting my philosopher's hat on, I can use reason to discover there are certain objective relationships between people that we cannot change based on human opinion. So, for example, I believe friendship is an objective reality. So friendship is something where friendship is a kind of relationship where two people are engaged in the benefit for one another and share mutual interests, you know, whatever you want. I would not say that the bully who makes someone do his math homework for him is his friend. That's an abuse of the term. That relationship could never be friendship. It's an objective thing. But I would say that the relationship that exists between men and women, where they fully give themselves to one another in a lifelong monogamous bond, where they form a one flesh biological union, the apt term for that is marriage or matrimony. In fact, the word matrimony comes from Latin for mother, you know, to procreate, to give birth, you know, to give birth to. And then that makes sense. That explains this kind of universal recognition of the desire to solemnize the unions between men and women, and then to understand that that's a unique kind of bond with unique things related to it. That I think you see that marriage is something, and you have an idea of what it is.
I think I just disagree with these ideas that that friendship is an objective thing that exists. I think it's a culturally defined thing. I think friendship would look different in different cultures at different times throughout human history. I think marriage has looked different in different cultures throughout history.
Yeah, there are things that are going to change. I mean, even in the Catholic Church, we have the Eastern Rite and the Western Rite, where there's different, you know, one rite, the priest is the one who marries you, and the other rite, it's the bride and groom marry each other. And I go to an Eastern Catholic Church, so there's different rites. The one you and your listeners are most, you know, Protestants are familiar with is the Latin Rite.
Yeah.
The largest one. I'm actually Byzantine. They've got this wonderful tradition where the bride and groom each wear a crown, and the crowns are of equal size and weight and always have been to show that they're equal partners in this and marry one another. So you're right. There's going to be marriage traditions, friendship traditions that differ, but there's a bare minimum of what makes something a friendship and what makes something a marriage. That's just universal. But we're getting into philosophy. Yeah. I don't want to get too far away. Let's go.
Can I throw out a Jesus thing real quick?
Yeah, I feel bad. Paul's been on the back burner for a while here. But go one last one, and then let's talk about Paul.
Paul
for
is
a bit.
Not the incarnation of God, so he's fine. But
that's true. But I believe he's an apostle that Jesus chose, had confidence in, and was inspired to write the Bible. So for me, it's still a big deal.
Sure. The one thing, and I used to think that this was a weak argument, but the more I studied it during my master's thesis, looking culture and context, Jesus' interaction and New Testament interactions with eunuchs is something that a lot of people have rolled their eyes at, but John Boswell did a lot of good work on. And I actually think that there's something to be said. Eunuchs are definitely the sexual minorities in the first century Greco-Roman world. These are people who many would argue, and I have passages in this book from first century sources, that would argue that these are similar to the equivalent of gay men. Some of these people, we could argue that these are intersex people. Some people would argue these are trans people.
Traditionally, though, they've been people who are castrated to be trusted around queens and other female royalty.
Which today we might identify, and it's, you've got to be careful here to honor the trans community, but you might identify that as a transgender person, a person who's willfully gone and transitioned the way their gender is expressed. Mm-hmm.
And that, well, we've been LG here for a while, and a little bit with the B. The T is going to be an entirely different show, which I'm happy to do at another time. Maybe I'll be back for that. But yeah, well, with eunuchs, Jesus talks about how there are people who are born eunuchs, people who made eunuchs, and people who have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven, which many people interpret to be those who have taken vows of celibacy, since people who are eunuchs are also celibate because they can't engage in the marital act.
I think the celibacy argument is weak based on evidence of what we have for first century Greco-Roman world, what eunuchs are expressed as, how they're written about by non-biblical sources. I think it's a really strong, I think it's a strong argument to say these are sexual minorities, whether you want to put them under LGB or T, these are sexual minorities. And the way Jesus treats them, and then the way they're treated in the book of Acts as being the first people baptized into the church, I think there's something there that needs to be grappled with about what Jesus' disposition is.
Well, you're talking about when Philip meets the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8. Well, here, that would probably fall under my definition. This person, we don't know what his sexual attractions or orientations are. He could be a straight man who's had his testicles removed because then he's trusted to guard the queen, basically. I mean,
yeah, that's one instance. But it's I would say, from my understanding of the historical sources, it's almost never just a celibate person. Jesus was a celibate person and not called a eunuch. Eunuchs are sexual minorities. These are either people who were born intersex or with an inability to use their sexual organs in the way that they're normally used.
Right.
They're people who are made eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom, which there's a lot of ambiguity about what exactly that means. And then there are those who become eunuchs, and that there are some cases for people to serve in royal courts. And there are clear cases, again, the book has first century references and fourth century references about people who have become eunuchs because that's an expression of who they believe themselves to be. And so whether we're talking about trans or LGB, I do think the eunuch, if anybody's actually serious and wants to have a serious argument about this, I would just encourage folks and listeners to dig in and talk about how Jesus, what is a eunuch, look it up, read the book, and see that Jesus is at least having a gracious disposition towards this group of people.
But I agree with you that, and I think that there's a dichotomy here in thinking, okay, how do we reach out to people like Jesus did for those who have lived apart from God for a very long time? And what made Jesus merciful was not an accommodation of behavior that's at variance with God's law, but a merciful compassion to not abandon people to those sins. So for example, like prostitutes, tax collectors. I mean, tax collectors were the villainous scum of first century Judea. And Jesus, you know, would scandalize people today for, you know, it'd be like if he was off with Bernie Madoff or something like that. And yet he's reached out to these people, not because he condoned what they were doing, even if it's saying the gospel reaches the Samaritan woman who had five husbands or the eunuch, whatever that eunuch, the Ethiopian eunuch was doing, that it's reaching these people in spite of the fact that they're very far from God, God wants them to be closer to him, not necessarily an endorsement of everything that they do.
But I would say the key point here is that there's never a condemnation, only a welcome, only a blessing to eunuchs in both the Gospels and the rest of the New Testament.
That would get us in far afield about what that means, because yeah. I would agree that someone who is born intersex, someone who has ambiguous genitalia or even has something like Turner syndrome or Klinefelter syndrome, they're a man or woman made in the image and likeness of God, deserve to be treated with respect. They're not barred from the kingdom, and we ought to treat them with ethical, compassionate medicine. So that is a separate how we...
But it's an interesting philosophical question. We won't go down it, but I just want to pose it. So you have an intersex person who the doctors will determine at birth what their gender is. They may or may not then be a homosexual for the rest of their life, whether they appear homosexual or not. What is the theological argument for them?
About what?
If you're an intersex person and you're born with both female parts and male parts, and what often happens is the doctors will choose which part you're going to have to be a healthy human.
To identify what you are, yeah.
Yes. There's no science behind knowing what the gender identity of a person is. They're arbitrarily choosing.
Well, gender identity is something that's subjective. I mean, you have people who have very clear genotypes and phenotypes and yet say that they're the opposite sex. So gender identity is a subjective phenomenon of what a person conceives of himself or herself or ski self. Or...
Well, the sex is, but the sex is ambiguous. Somebody's making an arbitrary choice.
I would say even in I'm going to the last word on this because I want to move on because this is another subject we could go down. In the vast majority of intersex cases, it's very clear we can determine that what is present in this patient is a male or female who has some kind of stunted development or abnormal phenotype. That we can still, even in Turner's, Klinefelter, supermale syndrome, XYY, XXYY, in the vast majority of these cases, I've only found one case in literature where it becomes hard, where you have someone with chromosomal mosaicism who is 46XY and becomes pregnant, you know, but that is the, even that they're like 80-20 XXXY. So it, you know, or 80-80. The point is very slim majority of cases where we're not sure. But to make an analogy, to say from these very tiny, tiny minority of cases that we can't figure out whether people are men or women would be like saying that there are a sliver of cases where we're not sure if someone's alive or dead. There's a guy named TK, for example. He is brain dead. He has no electrical activity in his brain, but his body is not decomposed, was not decomposing. You feed him, he's alive. Like, well, is he alive or is he dead? You know, but in the vast majority of cases, we can still see who's alive and who's dead, even if there are these minority cases where we're not sure.
I think just the point that I'm trying to make, and it's the first thing I said on the podcast today, is sexuality and gender identity altogether is one of the most complex topics we can talk about of humanity.
Sure.
And jumping to theological answers about how sexuality and gender identity are expressed with black and white clarity, I find just to be an unwise path to go forward.
But you have a black or white standard yourself. You would say that, you know, you and I would agree that rape is wrong. That is just obvious. That's a sexual sin. And then we put other sexual sins under. I think you and I agree incest is wrong. Committed relationships are good.
Rape and incest aren't part of our God-wired identity. As I would say, homosexuality, heterosexuality is.
Well, let me give you an example with incest. And I agree some people use that example poorly. But, you know, Paul condemns it in 1 Corinthians 5. And I'll give you an example that I don't think falls prey to the idea that, well, this is obviously wrong because there's familial abuse. Suppose two men have a romantic relationship with each other. They meet each other. They're, you know, just a few years apart. But then they do a genetic test, and it turns out they're half-brothers because their father is a sperm donor. And this is actually not uncommon. People are dealing with now, with the rise of sperm and egg donors, that people are becoming romantically involved with people that are their half-brothers and half-sisters.
Yeah.
So then here it would seem like if one opposes these relationships, it's because of a particular genetic difference between these two people. That logic would seem to carry over towards the argument that of the genetic and biological differences between men and women mattering.
Yeah, just hearing that argument, I don't know that the reason that we oppose incest is there are scientific biological reasons why incest is bad. And if reproduction happens out of incest, there are lots of terrible consequences that are possible.
Well, there can be, but that's between opposite sex incest,
right.
One. And then two, but I don't think that's the sine qua non, because there's statistical evidence that women who have children over the age of 40 are more likely to have Down syndrome children or children with genetic abnormalities. That doesn't make it wrong to have relations with someone who's an older woman, for example.
No, but this is where I do lean on science and doctor's wisdom. And a lot of doctors would say, hey, woman over 40, you should probably not try to get pregnant because you're going to increase the risk of having a child that's harmed. Lost my train of thought on all of this stuff.
That's okay. But my point is that I hear this too sometimes, and I've listened to other dialogues between traditionalists and revisionists.
Yeah.
I listened to the one with on Unbelievable with Gagnon and Ozan.
Yeah.
I don't know if you got a chance to listen to that one. I met Gagnon a few years ago. He's a hilarious guy, but he's definitely comes at you like a machine gun.
Exactly.
Basically,
a bit extreme.
He's forceful and confident in his view, and I don't think that's wrong, because Ozan said in the dialogue, like, you know, Robert, your certainty is the problem here. Like, you're just so darn certain. But I would say any of us who come to the table on this question are like, you're certain that the relations between two men or two women that are committed are not sinful. Like, we all have equal degrees of certainty.
I wouldn't say certain. I always argue, and I say this in my church nearly every week when I get up to preach, we're arguing for epistemological humility. So I'm saying this is my best understanding of what I understand the Bible to teach, how I understand the world, how I perceive myself. Mm-hmm. I'm not certain of anything. I think that this is the right way to go. I advocate it because mm-hmm. I believe it's right, but I'm open always to my mind being changed on anything. Mm-hmm. And even as an LGBT activist, I've always said this, I think it's right because of science and reason and my Christian faith,
right,
that I'm an LGBT person. But
and so your standard, I just want to put it out here for what makes something sexually sinful or not. Because you know, mine's related to the monogamous bond between man and woman in marriage.
Yeah.
It's related to committed relationship, and it's, so far it seems the things that it would preclude in our conversation have been adult incest, and because you're open to premarital sex, to polyamory, you're open to these things.
Sure.
So we'll just take it as just a given. We're talking about relationships that are not exploitative.
Sure.
Among non-exploitative relationships, it seems like the only thing that you have a problem with would be incestuous ones, and of course also ones that are that would be between a human and a non-human,
because there are scientific biological reasons why those relationships are not good.
Well, okay, so what's interesting here, it seems to me that your standard for whether something is sinful or not, it's not really what we derive from the Bible, it's what we derive from like scientific studies,
because I do take an ethical standard on questions of these personal ethics. And I know you disagree on my interpretation of Romans 14, but for people who want to dig deeper into it, Ken Wilson wrote a book called A Letter to My Congregation, which articulates it much better than I am here. But it's this ethic that says we center around Christian values, but the way those values are expressed is different in different contexts for different people. So I call people to the fruit of the Spirit. I call people mm-hmm. to commitment and covenant and love, and recognize that for some people, that's going to look different. For some people, premarital sex is sinful. For some people, I don't think it is.
Why? What would be the difference?
Conscience.
Paul, so it's just how you feel, if it's sinful or not.
Paul says in Romans 14 mm-hmm. that it's a matter of conscience between these people. Should we eat these things? Should we not eat these things? Should we celebrate this? Should we not celebrate? Should we do this or
but
not?
But he doesn't take that same stand. And so we'll end with Paul. I know he's been waiting for a while. And we'll just go to 1 Corinthians 5 and 6, that he doesn't take that stand, though, when it comes to sexuality. He talks about how being connected to a prostitute is the same one flesh union you would make with a spouse, that the sex involved there is a very serious thing. It can preclude you from entering the kingdom of heaven. And in 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 10, he talks about how two particular groups of people, it's translated in different ways. We could do a whole show on how it's translated. But he presents a vice list of things that can keep you out of the kingdom of God. And so, he talks about the immoral, porneia, idolaters, adulterers, homosexuals, what the RSV says, thieves, the greedy, drunkards, revilers, robbers will inherit the kingdom of God. He lists these vices not at, well, if your conscience, if you think, getting drunk on the weekend or being a greedy businessman is okay, or adultery. He just lists them. And for homosexuals, he has two Greek words, and that's where people can disagree. I don't want to. When do you have to head out of here? We already went too long. When do you got to go?
I can do 10 more minutes.
Okay, all right. But this is...
It's good.
This is good. I mean, when we have to keep having these conversations, we'll see where we agree, where we disagree. Why don't we just summarize the cases and then people can take from this so they know the debate.
Sure.
The Greek words are arsenikoitai and the malakoi.
Yep.
The traditional view holds arsenikoitai is a word possibly that Paul coined that seems to be a literal translation of mishkab zakur in Hebrew, that in Leviticus, the words arsena and koitai literally mean man better, one who beds men, has sex with men. And the malakoi are soft, effeminate. The traditional view would hold that these two individuals are the active partner and the passive partner in male same-sex relationships. The revisionist view has a different take on it, I guess.
Yeah. I mean... Ish. I think the First Corinthians passage is really important because I think it's a condemnation, clearly, again, of exploitive relationship between older men and younger boys. I do think Paul is talking about pederasty, and I think if we would have been interpreting it that way, not to cast aspersions, but both the Catholic Church and the Protestant Church would have a little bit more accountability with pedophile relationships and things like that, because I think that's what Paul's getting at. He's trying to protect people, and by taking these two words, arsenikoitai being a word, like you said, that's never used before this, only used after, Paul coins the term. It's a literal translation from Leviticus.
Well, okay, I'm going to fire back just a little. Do you think it's wrong for teenagers to have sex?
With each other?
Yeah.
Probably not.
But it's wrong for them to have sex with adults?
Yes.
Why? What's the difference?
Power differential. We know that psychologically there's a difference. You said it earlier in our conversation that adults are fully developed, youth are not fully developed. So for an adult to use their fully developed brain to exploit a youth who doesn't have the full capability to choose to be with an adult, I think that's differential.
But the two teenagers don't have the full capacity to choose to be with one another either. To me, that would be like saying, well, an adult can't give kids alcohol, but two teenagers can go get drunk.
It's not a great comparison. I would say that two people of equal brain development, they're not exploiting one another unless, I mean, there's other ways that it could
be. Well, that can happen among adults. But
yeah.
But here, I would say that I don't see that Paul doesn't use a Greek word for referring just to pederasty, like paiderastes or anything
like that.
Well,
he's using manbed and also malakoi, which malakoi has always been referred to generally as the passive partner.
Right.
Also, soft one is another way to translate it, is also often used to refer to the young boy in a pederastic relationship.
But then here's the problem, though. Why does Paul condemn the malakoi? Why doesn't he say just the arsenikoites? If they're the ones being abused and they're the victim here, why do they not inherit the kingdom of God?
Because I wrote a great chapter in my book about patriarchy that goes into this in depth. The problem here is that we're going to the way the Greco-Roman world, we're not going to have time to get into this in the way it needs to be explained, but in the Greco-Roman world, the way sexuality was viewed, the reason homosexuality was despised was because the active partner going into the passive partner was emasculating the passive partner and emasculating himself. By a man to have sex with another man, he was rendering the man being penetrated as a woman, which was seen as a terrible thing in the Greco-Roman world, and he was becoming guilty by being the one who was doing the emasculating work. So that person, the reason they're sinful in Paul's mind, in his Greco-Roman mind, is because that person has lowered their...
But then the objection is Paul using this one Greco-Roman patriarchal standard? Or is he, like we see in Romans, for example, is he calling back to Genesis and the created order standard? I would say that there's no... It's not patriarchy here that's motivating Paul. He's going back to what Leviticus has said. But also in the Greco-Roman world, you had consensual adult relationships that were not looked down upon. In Plato's Symposium, there are homosexual relationships between adults that aren't looked down upon.
No, totally. And I would absolutely affirm that. But when we're talking, there's so many aspects to go here. I think the Apostle Paul, first of all, I take the view that I have a lower view of Scripture, first of all. We haven't articulated that on this podcast yet, but I don't believe in inerrancy. I wouldn't hold to those views. I have a view that the Bible is a book created by humans that God has spoken through faithfully for generations, but it contains errors. And I think Paul is a man of his time. Mm-hmm. I think Paul is writing from a human perspective, doing his best to communicate what he believes is from God. And I think we should expect to find these cultural Greco-Roman standards of the world that Paul is traveling and living in to find their way into the scripture. And this is where, even though William Webb would still hold a high view of scripture, he makes similar arguments. And anybody who's arguing for egalitarianism from the New Testament is making these similar arguments.
Right. People are arguing for, like, women should be pastors just as much as men.
Right. Right. And Paul says the exact opposite.
Right. But I actually agree with Paul here that, one, he doesn't hold that patriarchal view, because in 1 Corinthians 11, he allows women to prophesy in church. He doesn't believe that they have to be universally silent or subjective. In Romans 16, he has female co-workers. 1 Corinthians 7, a wife has conjugal rights over her husband's body.
I agree with you, and that's the ethical trajectory of scripture, but Paul doesn't oppose patriarchy. With all of that, there's always caveats of women being subservient.
Right, but the Catholic Church holds it's an infallible teaching that the priesthood itself is reserved to men based on Jesus' selection of the 12 apostles. But no, I'm
whole different concept.
I'm closing it off because you got to get back to work. And this was, I think this was productive. I think a lot of people will learn a lot from what we've discussed. And I would encourage you. So I tell you what, here's how I would like to end it. Please point our listeners towards resources that you find are helpful for your view.
Sure.
And then I will point them towards resources I find helpful for the view that I've been articulating, and then that will allow them to go a little bit deeper. So
totally.
Go right on ahead.
I think one of the best books that I ever read on this was Sex and the Single Savior by Dale Martin from Westminster John Knox Press. Great book, and he does a really good job of fairly succinctly going deep into culture, context, and scripture, and he holds a fairly high view of scripture as he's articulating. You've already mentioned, I think for people just trying to get into skimming the surface, both Justin Lee and Matthew Vines have written books. Justin Lee's is called Torn.
Rescuing the Bible from
God versus gay
Christian debate. Yes.
Yeah. And then Matthew Vines is God and the Gay Christian. I think John Boswell, I've grown to like him more and more. William Loder, I've grown to like more and more. I think both of them have good arguments. And then Colby Martin, who's another San Diego-based pastor, wrote a book called Unclobber. He's a straight pastor, used to be a pastor at our church. And his book has kind of become one of the standard books in the past couple years. So it's called Unclobber by Colby Martin. Those are just to get you skimming the surface. And then if you want to go deeper, my book, The Gospel of Inclusion, I do think it presents an argument that you're not going to find in any mm-hmm. of those other texts.
Sure. And then I would recommend for listeners, if you want to go deeper from the view that I've been defending, probably the best defender is Robert Gagnon. He has a book called The Bible and Homosexual Practice. I think we referenced him earlier. He comes at you with footnotes upon footnote, though he has obviously his critics. And his website, robertgagnon.net, he responds to more of his critics. Other books I would recommend, I think Kevin DeYoung has a book called What Does the Bible Teach on Homosexuality? And you dialogue with Preston Sprinkles. I don't know if he wrote anything on this. Has he written anything?
Yeah, he wrote a book called A People to Be Loved.
Yes, that's
it. I know this is anathema, but I'm going to throw it in. My good friend, Father James Martin, wrote a great book on this called Bridging the Divide, I believe.
Building a bridge. I saw on his Twitter, he mentioned you in your book.
Yeah.
Right? Did he read the book or have any thoughts on it? Or
yeah, he when we were hanging out in New York a few months ago, he just promoted it out there for me and got a lot of pushback for it. But I think he's
so there was no part of the book that he expressed any reservations about? He just thought it was
good? Oh, I'm sure he has reservations, but we didn't
get into that.
Yeah.
Okay, but he was happy to, he promoted it to people. And
right. I think he gets unfairly attacked in the Catholic world, but I think he's doing a good job for what he's trying to do and occupy space where there can be healing between the LGBT people and the Catholic Church. So,
The other thing I'd recommend, so Preston Sprinkles, Kevin DeYoung, Robert Gagnon, and then finally, listeners, great resource, apostolate within the church is Courage. Courage is an apostolate that helps people with same-sex attractions lead chaste lives. My friend Father Paul Cech used to run it, and now it's the executive director is Father Philip Bachansky. Wonderful guy. Be sure to check out Courage. I think their website is courageRC.net or .com, but Courage, Catholic Apostolate, you can't miss it. Brandon, thanks for being on the show today. I appreciate it.
It's so good to be with you.
And thank you guys for listening, and I hope you have a very blessed day.